Hello. Welcome to our service of worship for Sunday, April 25th, the fourth Sunday of Easter. I invite those of you who have a bulletin to turn to the first page if, like me, you need a little help with this. Otherwise, I know many of you do know it from memory. Let us join in Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. I invite you to sing to yourself or find music for O For a Thousand Tongues. Then I invite you to turn to the top of page 2 and join together in our prayer of confession. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we don't always appreciate the Good Shepherd. We prefer to go our own way rather than where he leads us. Forgive us, we pray. Help us to know him as he knows us. Amen. Children of God, know that the Good Shepherd cares for each of us. In that caring, we are forgiven. Alleluia and amen. Our first scripture lesson today comes, as it has in this season of Easter, from the book of Acts. The next day, their rulers, elders, and scribes assembled in Jerusalem with Annas, the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. When they had made the prisoners stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who was sick, and are asked how this man had been healed, let it be known to all of you, and to all the people of Israel, that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved." And then from 1 John 3, we know love by this, that Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses help? Little children, let us love, not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before God whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and God knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from God whatever we ask, because we obey the commandments and do what pleases God. And this is God's commandment, that we should believe in the name of the Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. All who obey the commandments abide in God, and God abides in them. And by this we know that God abides in us, by the Spirit that was given us. And then from the 10th chapter of the Gospel of John, we hear these words. Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father." Our second hymn is "How Firm a Foundation." Psalm 23 is probably one of the best known and most loved psalms for many of us. I learned it in the King James Version, as have many of our residents, which is why it is one of the scripture lessons I do not usually print in a more modernized version. But today we get the lesson from the psalm, and we get the lesson from John, where Jesus speaks of himself as the good shepherd. For him, it is a continuation of that shepherd to whom David wrote his psalm so many years earlier. But for a moment at least, I want to focus on the words from 1 John. John writes that it was important that we remember those who do not have. The exact words are, "Little children, how does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses help?" In spite of all of the economic downturns that COVID has caused, the United States of America is still, by far, one of the wealthiest nations on earth. And yet, every day, we have people dying of starvation. We have people dying as they are homeless. On average, the city of LA has 5 homeless people die every single day. So, a judge has ordered that the city of Los Angeles find housing promptly by October for all of its homeless. That's a worthy goal. I applaud it. But underlying that is some heartache. First of all, the heartache that we live in a culture that has so many people who are homeless and who have done so little to help alleviate that situation. But heartache enhanced by the fact that one of the primary motivators for getting the homeless people into homes was not to house them, but because people were complaining that their parks had been taken over and they couldn't use their parks anymore. Those who have are called upon to give to others and to use their resources for others. It is, quite frankly, part of the great challenge our nation faces on our southern border. We have so much. And while we certainly have all kinds of horrific violence and terror in our own streets and homes, for most of us, that is nothing compared to the day-to-day horror that people from Honduras and Guatemala are experiencing. It is so severe that people are paying others to take their very young children and smuggle them into our country. And yes, now it is becoming our burden and our challenge. But for those of us who follow Christ, there must always be some willingness to try to respond. There has been much made about the voting laws in Georgia, which are clearly discriminatory and make things difficult for many. But the one part of that legislation that not only breaks my heart, but angers me, and I suspect angers Christ, is that it is now against the law to give water or food to someone standing in line to vote. When did we see you thirsty and give you drink? And Jesus says, when you do this for the least of these, you do it for me. We say that psalm about preparing a table before us. And we as Christians also believe that the table that we celebrate at communion is part of that table. But it is also the table at which we receive our daily bread. Bread that we are called upon to share with one another. And we as humans find sometimes those calls to be too challenging. So how do we succeed in answering those calls? Not by ourselves, but with the help of the good Shepherd, the one who gathers us, the one who leads us, the one who seeks us when we are lost, the one who feeds us, the one who takes us to still waters. Sometimes we are like sheep, lost and confused and making foolish choices. If you haven't already seen it, I do encourage you to Google. It's a YouTube video of sheep in trench. The video begins with a young boy at a trench, and all you see is the kind of waggly tail and the kicking feet. And even as he's struggling to pull the animal out, it is kicking and fighting because it doesn't know who's behind him and what's going on. But he manages to pull this sheep out of this trench, and he sets it beside the trench. Now there's a fence, and there's some dirt, and there's the trench, and there's more dirt, and there's a road. And we see the sheep kind of shake itself off and go bounding down the dirt. And it bounds into the air to leap to the other side and falls head first into the same trench, 20, 30 feet further down. And even though it is filmed from the rear, you can see and perceive the dismay on the boy's face to realize he's going to have to go through this all over again. I think sometimes that young boy represents what Jesus must feel with us. rescuing us, saving us, giving us new life, and then we plunge headlong into the same abyss. The video does not show the boy going and rescuing the sheep again. But Scripture tells us that Christ does save us again and again and again. And ultimately, we know that we are saved from ourselves through the resurrection of our Lord. As we continue in this season of Easter, that should be the focus of our joy and our celebration. And it should be a call to wake up from foolish sheep-like ways and to shake ourselves off and look around and see, first of all, our blessings and be grateful for them, but then strive to find ways to share what we have with others. It isn't easy. Sometimes it is downright painful because it means sacrifice. Sacrifice as individuals, sacrifices for businesses, sacrifices as a society, sacrifices as a nation. But you know what, my friends? All of those sacrifices are nothing compared to the sacrifice of Christ. And if he could do what he did in an effort to try to save us, we can do our part to help be his hands and feet on this earth at this time and to help save others so that someday all may be fed in green pastures and enjoy an overflowing table of goodness through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Merciful and loving God, we are a nation that has seen so much recently. The unrest after deaths, the horrors of civilians killing one another in schoolyards and grocery stores and bars. And we, as a nation, held our collective breath as we awaited a verdict. And yet, sometimes, O God, we are called to pause and to hold our breath as we reflect on your verdict for humankind. And we rejoice that your verdict is always a decision to act in love. And so you came as Christ Jesus to teach us of your love, to teach us to love one another, to call us to discipleship, to bring us to life everlasting. As our world continues to battle COVID, as many nations are dealing with resurgences leading to full ICUs, as many in this country are vaccinated and others, for so many reasons, are hesitant to do so, we continue to pray for a world affected by COVID. We pray for our community here at Three Pillars. We rejoice that we have been able to have some visitors, to have some traditional events and experiences begin to happen, perhaps in slightly different ways. But they are happening, and we rejoice in the diligence of so many hard-working frontline staff to ensure the health and safety of our residents. We pray for our residents, we pray for their families and friends, we pray for staff and their families and friends. But we also pray for your whole great world, For we are all part of your flock, for we are all your children. We take time now to pause and offer you silent prayers for our personal needs today. Gracious God, we offer you our prayers for self, for healing of mind, body, or spirit. We pray for a world that is so broken. And we pray, O God, that someday those who thirst will have not just water, but the living water. We pray that those who hunger will be fed not just with earthly food, but at your heavenly home. We pray that we might be the hands that strive to serve you, to care for others, to share what we have. We offer all our prayers, O God, confident that you hear and that you respond with love. We have this faith because we have the teaching and assurances, the everlasting promises of Jesus the Christ, our Lord and Savior, our Good Shepherd. We gather in his name, and together we rejoice to join in the prayer that Christians have shared for so long. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our final hymn is My Life Flows On in Endless Song. Forth, following the Good Shepherd to green pastures and still waters. Feast at the table provided. Celebrate God's love as shown through Christ. Amen. If you have a bulletin, you will note the reminder that next Sunday's service will be a communion service. I invite you to plan ahead and have elements ready at home. Elements will be provided here on campus for our residents. Go in peace.